The first song you wrote after being released from the hospital is called Murder of Crows. Can you talk a bit about that song and the motivation of it?
Yeah, I mean, that was the first song when I got out of the hospital. When I got out of the hospital, I'd realized, you know, there was a certain group of friends and people in my life that really stuck with me through the really tough times. They were there for the good times, but they stuck with me through all that. But then there was, oddly enough, like the people that were the closest to me, someone who was even in my family, and people that I sort of brought right from the very beginning, people I grew up with and went to school with, that were, you know, it was a small group of my really, really close friends. As soon as things got bad for me, they just split. You know, they were gone. And that surprised me the most because they were – I did the thing that you're supposed to do, you know, when you have success is you stick with the people that you knew way before that.
Yeah.
Your family and things like that, and because they'll never screw you. Well, they were the ones who screwed me. So not only did they just leave me, I mean, then I found out like throughout that whole time they were stealing from me and, you know, things like that. So I became really angry, and, you know, that's what that song's about, is about that group of, say, four or five people in my life that are just at this point, you know, I just remember saying they're dead to me, you know, I can't talk to them anymore. And then that song just kind of came out of nowhere. That was the first one.
Do you spend much time reflecting on the fact that had this not happened to you, you might never have known the reality of those relationships?
I probably would have figured it out. But yeah, it probably would have taken a lot longer. And, you know, who knows how I would have reacted. But I think being really clear and sober, it wasn't that I found out because I was sober. I would have found out anyway. I think the way I reacted to it. When you're sober, you just have no time for stuff like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
When you're drinking, you can kind of let things go.
Yeah.
You know, it's because you don't want to ruin the moment. You're having a good time. It's like, why deal with any
good
of that?
Good buzz. Don't bring the buzz down. Yeah. That's right.
When you're sober, you have no time.
There are also, though, tons of writers in history who think that that buzz adds to their writing ability.
Mm-hmm.
What was it like for you to write sober?
It was awful at first.
Was it?
Yeah. I mean, I would love to do it now, but going through that process of recovery and all that work, I had to do all the physiotherapy and all the AA and all that kind of stuff, and all these thoughts that are going on in your mind, all this doubt and insecurity and, you know, overanalyzing. That was awful to be writing in that period. Learning how to be yourself again through, you know, just learning how to be in public, and everything was so new, especially since I've been drinking since I was a teenager. You know, I went 17 years without not very many days off of drinking.
Did you have a sense that you were an alcoholic, or did you just think, no?
I knew that I partied quite a bit. I felt like I was an alcoholic by the last year, and I think that's what it was. I always had a pretty good handle on it.
Right.
I could go into party mode, but I can be in sober work mode at the same time. And, you know, I would float in between, in and out of those two kind of, you know, lifestyles. Whereas, say, the last year and a half, it got really bad. And that's when I knew at that point that this was something I was going to have to deal with. I just wasn't quite ready. It's one of those, I'll deal with it tomorrow sort of situations. And of course, tomorrow never comes.
In the front of Nikki Sixx's book, The Heroin Diaries, he puts an Oxford definition of addiction, which is the standard addiction. And then he says, definition of addiction, according to Lemmy Kilmister, which is, it's anything I can quit whenever I want, as long as that's next Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But not certainly not today.
Yeah, yeah.
You got to today. You finally got to next Tuesday. We're just talking about how hard it was to write at the beginning. I've seen it written everywhere that people who drink excessively, eat excessively, do drugs excessively, whatever, that there are sometimes things that they're trying to mask or to escape from. Was that your experience? Did you find that all of a sudden in recovery, all this stuff was like up in your face as you were trying to create?
You know, I don't think so. It was, I mean, the way I party, it was because it was fun.
Yeah.
You know, life was pretty good sober. I didn't really have any issues to hide or mask. It was just a fun release because I work so hard.
Right.
And it was always a great time. And I'm a really happy drinker. So it was always a good time.
Mm.
And everybody I know drinks. You know, it wasn't like it was just me and nobody else was around.
Yeah, you weren't the drunk guy in the room.
No, it was everybody in my life partied hard. You know, that's just what we did. I would say when I went through my divorce, the pain of that was probably the first time I started drinking probably a little bit more to sort of hide or mask that, you know.
Right.
And then I was injured and I hurt my back, and that was physical pain. And it was – I realized, you know, every time I had a couple of drinks, I felt better.
Take the pain away.
The pain would go away. And I thought – I used to say to myself, well, this is much better than probably being addicted to painkillers. You know, I'd rather just have a couple of drinks and let – you know, that's much better. But, you know, I was already topping up what I was already doing, which was already excessive, you know. So that's when it escalated and turned into sort of a physical dependency.
So do you have any, like, new techniques you have to use when you're writing now?
I don't know. I mean, with that record, yeah, but to start me off, because I couldn't really write anything at first. Nothing was coming. What I would do is I would put on movies with no sound and just start trying to write guitar riffs and things just to the images. So whatever the images were inspiring – and I would put on Tim Burton kind of movies, you know, sort of creative and inspiring visuals.
Yeah, yeah.
And Quentin Tarantino movies like Kill Bill and stuff like that. So I had like Edward Scissorhands and Kill Bill and Inglourious Bastards, Sweeney Todd. And it just sort of made me start writing things in a different way.
That's some great creative inspiration. It obviously worked out. The album's first official single is called War. You've said that writing War has actually saved your life. What did you mean by that?
Well, when I wrote those lyrics, I was sort of at a tipping point in my recovery because it had been about a year and it felt like it was a never-ending recovery that had no progress. I just didn't feel like I was getting any better whatsoever. And I could have easily at that moment just said, you know, I'm just going to go back to drinking because this is no way to live. I can't live in this much pain. I can't live this is not really a life. I'd rather, if that's going to kill me, I'd rather just at least enjoy myself.
Die happy.
You know? And this sort of lyric just popped into my head at that moment of what am I fighting for? And, you know, then I thought, well, everything back and more. I want what I had, but more. I want more out of life than I had before. And it sort of gave me this thought of what it means to really have faith in something, you know, that to believe in something that you don't know what the outcome is going to be. It's sort of believing in the unknown, because even the doctors, like I said, didn't know if I was going to get better. But I thought if I fight and I work even harder than I've been working, I'll get there. And as long as I believe it, you know, that's what's going to push me forward. Or rather, pull me. And so that's what I did. And I came out for the better, you know. I'm still very much the same. I'm definitely different, but I'm also older. You know, you change as you get older. There's just life experience. Of course, you know, life experience will sort of dictate your sort of view of existence. So, yeah, as I get older and the more things I go through, I think that it'll always change me.
So now you're going to go out and tour the album.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to tour sober.
Yes.
What's that going to be like?
It's actually really good. You know, we've been on tour for the better part of this whole year. And I really enjoy it. You know, because you feel more. You notice things more. And being on stage, I used to think that if I didn't drink before I went on stage, and I never really got too drunk before I went on stage. I mean, we all drank before. And the other guys still do drink before they go on. But you always had a couple drinks to sort of loosen up and get a little buzz and go out there. And I used to think if I didn't do that, it might be boring, you know, on stage because I had so much fun when I had a couple drinks. But it's actually – I find I'm having more fun now on stage than I was when I had a couple drinks. And I don't really want to change that, you know, at least for right now. I mean, that's the thing. I'm not really like a one-day-at-a-time person. I'm just – everything just feels really good and I don't really feel tempted and everything is so great. So I don't really want to disrupt that. But I also know, you know, that may not last forever and it may become difficult sometime. I have no idea. All I know is for right now, it's great and it seems easy and I enjoy it.